My daughter Marie is precious to us. And the first 2 months, everything was really good. And we were the happiest parents in the world. Her mother then detected that things are a little bit strange in terms of her hearing.
When Charlie was born, there were no issues. And when Charlie was 5 months old, we started noticing that he wasn't reaching with both of his hands. And then around 7 to 8 months old, I started noticing he was doing this clenching with his teeth.
Our son, Luke, when he was just a few months old, we started noticing some developmental delays. I think one of the first things we noticed was a misalignment of his eyes. And shortly after that, he had a lot of difficulty gaining weight, and just keeping weight on it became a really significant concern. And some of his other milestones weren't being met.
We just had like more issues. She ended up getting the eye surgery because her eyes couldn't keep straight. And then, you know, then she, you know, 12 months passed, you know, she's not walking. Like, I know like 18 months is like late typical, right? And then she's not walking 18 months.
So when Sarah was about 16 months old, we realized that she had her first seizure.
She was born with no issues. She was developing, though she was a little late on all of her milestones, but there were no concerns from the pediatrician.
Scarlett's 2.5 now, but she was 3 months or before that. My mama heart knew she was having seizures. Fast forward to she was 3 months old at daycare and she had a seizure there, and they recorded it and they said, this is a seizure. They confirmed seizure, and I'm like, well, that's all the recordings that we have.
With Ava, life can change at the drop of a hat. One moment we could be at a pumpkin patch, riding a carousel, having a great time, and in the next moment, we're in the hospital and we're hooked up to an EEG and we're struggling to figure out why we're seizing, why we're going through a cluster, why they're not stopping.
We have to make constant life or death decisions with very little information.
One of the most difficult things I've ever had to do in my life was to take my son and watch them put a mask over his face and for him to go limp in my arms.
As a mother, the worst imaginable thing is to see your child blue in the face, unresponsive, limp, and lifeless. And that is when Ava received her very first lifelight, which I could not accommodate her with. So not only did I feel helpless in that situation, but I also had to hand over my prized possession to other people in hopes that they were going to save her life.
She had every test under the sun done. They couldn't find anything wrong. They didn't know why she was having these seizures.
Why are we trying to stick a Band-Aid on something that's not healing? You know, we need to find what's actually causing her seizures and see if we can do something about that.
The doctor came in, was just like, yeah, whatever she has, it's gonna be really rare. And I was like, you have all the doctors in the world, you have 40 years of combined medical practicing with children, you can come in here in 30 seconds and decide my child's condition is rare, but that's all you can do. And he said, yeah, he's like, unfortunately, less than 50% are gonna find out even if you do genetics, and that's kind of the reality of it, and then left.
We got the diagnosis by the geneticist. She was 1.5 years. And she just hung up. And she was nice, but she didn't tell us what to do as a re-education.
My brother, luckily, is a geneticist and was like, push for this. And our doctors were able to push for it, but there was incorrect diagnosis where we were at in Charlotte, and that caused, I mean, we moved our entire lives from Charlotte back to Georgia.
Nobody had answers for us. You know, we went to her pediatrician, even her neurologist. It was just kind of this new thing, this GABA gene mutation, and nobody, you know, there wasn't anything we can Google, there wasn't anything we can look up.
When we got the genetic results, they gave us information that left more questions than answers. They couldn't tell us what to expect. We were lost. We have a name for the gene, but
no name for the condition, and certainly no information about what to expect.
When you don't have a child like this, you don't understand. And even my mom, even the closest person, don't understand.
We shouldn't live in this constant survival mode. Like, it changed life so much. It's a different reality people don't understand.
They want to understand, and they have love and they have compassion, but you really do not know this journey until you walk it and you live it.
My son is affected by this rare disease, but there are other children that are quite more affected in a very difficult way. It's amazing the courage they have, the mothers and the fathers. It's very hard.
I think there's more people out there with the same story, and we just need to find them.
Finally, we found a Facebook group, and it was Cure GABA-A.
If it had not been for the Cure GABA-A Foundation, my daughter's life would not be what it is today.
Monica reached out to me that evening after my message, and I received more information from her in that half an hour than I did from my doctors.
I had a phone call immediately set up with Monica, and that was like, oh my gosh, I found another mom who had, you know, a daughter similar in age with a similar story and the same, you know, gene mutation. So it was like a weight had been lifted.
We're at a pivotal point right now with rare disease that there's so much research being done in a lot of these disorders. There's markers that cover many of them that are very similar. And so if you're in a position to donate, not only will you help Spencer, but you'll help people just like her for years to come.
We already see up to 7 gene therapy that has been approved in the last decade. So we know that the trend is already favorable for us to develop this relevant technology. Now we have the knowledge from others' disorders, now we can apply to GABA-A variant.
We are no longer making genetic diagnoses with a clear ending. We don't know how the story will end, and it might end quite favorably.
We specialize in mRNA solid lipid nanoparticle technology. We'll be developing that technology for GABA-A. Actually, we already have. It's sitting in my fridge down in San Diego, and it's ready to go into clinic.
I think for Charlie too, the ultimate hope is that seizure control, to not have to watch him have seizures every day.
It would be nice to be able to communicate with my daughter one day. Anybody who's able to help, it would help us.
We need a lot of money to just help all those children, and it can be your child, so we have to help them and to raise money. That's the only solution.
Please help us to raise some funds to make it happen and to fight this disease all over the world.